A few weeks ago, I've shown you this Micropolis ESDI drive, which I had acquired a long time ago in the hopes to use it as a spare should I ever come by an IBM PC AT. However, the Micropolis hard drive turned out to be broken, and while working to restore my freshly acquired PC AT, it blew a capacitor on the disk controller. And even so, I could fix that. The erratic behavior I then observed with the original PC AT hard drive wasn't too promising. Obsolete computer technology is my passion. I'm the vintage collector, and these are my stories. The IBM PC AT marked many advancements in the industry when released in 1984. Built around the Intel 8286, supporting up to 16 MB of RAM, it also set many founding principles to define the PC architecture for years to come, including the 16-bit ISA bus, the increase from 8 to 15 IQs, and from 4 to 7 DMA channels. The standard 80 mainboard form factor, a default 1.2 MB 5 1/4 inch floppy drive, and a 20 or 30 MB hard drive. Although the previous model, the PCXT, also supported hard drives with capacities between 10 and 20 MB, the PCAT clearly raised the bar and received some praise. However, early revisions were plagued with hard drive issues. The IBM AT shipped by default with a 20 MB hard drive manufactured by CMI. And as history has recorded it, manufacturing quality was obviously subpar, with reported failure rates as high as 25 to 30%. And that seems to be directly related with the high demand IBM saw for the PC AT, which caused back pressure on CMI. With the issue causing some media attention, not to say also reputational impact on IBM themselves, as obviously there was also reported issues around the disk controller, this eventually led CMI to ceasing production of the flawed drives and IBM switching over to Seagate. So you may wonder what drive I've actually got in my AT, the dreaded CMI drive or the more reliable Seagate drive. As it seems, I'm on the bright side, it's the Seagate ST-4026. This drive uses modified frequency modulation recording, MFM for short, and is designated as a Type 2 hard drive. And that's definitely not the same drive my dad had in his PC AT, as I remember for certain he had a Type 21 drive with 30 MB. Anyway, I'm happy with what I have and we'll see in a moment if this drive still works or not. But first I need to fix the issue which caused the AT to blow a fuse during my first power on test. No surprise, it was a capacitor. A capacitor on the drive controller. This shouldn't be too hard to fix. Big thanks to PCBWay for sponsoring this video. If you're working on an electronics project, PCBWay is a fantastic choice for high quality PCB production and full turnkey assembly, offering fast turnaround times and professional manufacturing, just like this excellent drive adapter they produced for my previous IBM P70 restoration project. Check them out at PCBWay.com and get started on your next project today. As you see, it's actually multiple capacitors. The others didn't blow, but I'm gonna replace all of them. To begin with, I had to straighten the legs on those caps first so I can get better access with the desoldering iron. Now, I didn't have proper axial capacitors at hand, but radial caps only, and they will do as well. I only have to bend the legs around, so I can solder them in laying position. Said that, once all caps were replaced, I reseated the drive control and reconnected the drive. Fingers crossed it turns on. Alright, that seems to do it. As mentioned on my previous episode, the PC AT was the first IBM machine to not use DIP switches anymore for configuring the peripherals, but a software configurable CMOS setup. You can use the original IBM PC AT Diagnostics floppy to configure the system, although some sources claim it's also working using the general purpose G setup utility. As I had it at hand already, I gave it a shot to configure the Type 2 hard drive. But for reasons that didn't seem to work, and the system kept complaining about an invalid CMOS setup. So here we are in the much less user-friendly IBM Advanced Diagnostics, which I then used to register the hard drive. But to no avail, as on the next reboot, the BIOS would report me an error on disk 0. So back to the Advanced Diagnostics, where I want to run the system checkout for testing the hard drive. I use option 5 to perform all tests. And while this looked good at first, I then just saw yet another error. You may observe it's actually a different one than the BIOS error message, which just stated error 1790 disk 0 error. The error means to check the cable connections, but apparently all the cables are firmly plugged and also the pin 1 orientation is correct. The diagnostics then throws 1705 no record found at me. To me that sounds a lot like not only can't it read the disk, but maybe it's just missing the logical structure, so to say, the disk format. Of course, the drive may just be defective, but I'm thinking into running a low-level format, even so that's not the actual error indicating to require that measure. Still, I'll try the low-level format. The Advanced Diagnostics can help me with that as well. And it's anyway no bad idea, as I'm always reformatting all disks and drives no matter what source they came from. It will ask me for confirmation multiple times. Then I'll have to input the known defects list. IBM had asked their drive suppliers to place a label on each drive indicating known bad disk sectors. Production yield and quality really seem to have been a lot worse than today, or maybe it's just hidden away nowadays. Because, imagine for a second, you buy a new hard drive which comes with a defect list from the factory. Times had definitely been different 40 years ago. Anyway, once I hacked in all sectors, I'm ready to fire off the formatting process.
Are you really certain about this?
Which took an awfully long 3 hours to complete. But even then, I'd still receive the disk 0 error message on startup, and yet even DOS's F-disk would report an error reading from the hard drive. From the diagnostics, I still received the same 1705 error again. Then I ran another test, eventually getting this bad ECC error. so I was checking back at the error code list and suddenly felt like an idiot.
Literally?
Yes, he literally yelled it at me. Check the cable connection. We have to retake our excursions for the Seagate and ESDI disk drive interfaces. There's one 32-pin data cable with three posts and in most cases a twist before the far end connector. The primary drive goes to the far end connector. The drive also needs to have the line terminator set. The second drive, if one is available, not applicable for me here, goes to the middle post and has the terminator removed. Then there's an individual 20-pin data cable, one for each drive. For the IBM disk controller, the primary drive goes to connector J4, whereas the secondary drive goes to connector J3. Now, look again where I plugged my hard drive to J3. Because I didn't check and it just felt natural to use the lower J3 for the primary drive and the higher J4 would be for the secondary drive. But not, it's exactly the other way around. And you can definitely see it here that it originally was correctly connected. So my bad, and I corrected the cabling right away to rerun the low level format just because I didn't trust it did do it correctly the first time. Surprisingly, the low-level format ran a lot quicker this time round and completed within a few minutes. And thankfully, all the diagnostics will now pass as well. So maybe the drive isn't defective after all. I then pulled out this old copy of IBM PC DOS 3.3. This is still the original copy of my dad's. Even so, I had once a period in my life where I got rid of all my retro stuff, I kept this just for the nostalgia. As compared to later versions of DOS, installing DOS 3.3 is quite archaic. There's no setup program and you have to create the initial disk partitions manually through fdisk, then reboot and format the disk drive. It will appear to stall at some points with some different audible behavior which is due to the defective sectors. But eventually the format completes, so I create the C:\DOS directory and copy all files from the floppies onto the hard drive. I'll then also create an autoexec.bat file which will set the prompt and path arguments which will take effect after the next reboot. And it does reboot off the Type 2 hard drive. So after all, it's definitely not defective, even so Norton Disk Doctor exposes those bad blocks, but as I added them myself from the known defects list, it's clear these are not age-related defects, but came like this from the factory. I definitely learned something new today, and I'm so relieved I didn't break the drive with the wrong cabling. What puzzles me though is that while the system failed every test with the wrong cable connection, it still did something for the low level format. I would have expected to get errors at this stage instead. Now, one thing to note about the low level format. You may have observed that I didn't care for setting or changing the sector interleave option. On the present day, hard drives have built-in cache and can easily read an entire cluster into memory and systems are quick enough to process the data. That's why sector interleaving is no longer required since many years. But back in the days, both the hard drives and the CPUs were relatively slow. Said that, if a hard drive has no sector interleaving, these sectors are lined up in sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Depending on the system speed, after reading and processing the first sector, the platter will be on a different sector position, and with unadjusted sector interleave, it's very likely to not be the second sector, but just any sector. So the system then has to wait for another disk revolution to pass the next sequence sector. To increase performance, there's tools like Norton Utilities Disk Calibrate, which will measure the exact time and offer to adjust the sector interleaving without running a low-level format. Adjusting the sector interleaving could greatly affect your disk access performance by reducing unnecessary waiting time, as ideally the next sector comes by under the magnetic read-write head when processing has completed, so the system can continue seamlessly. Of course, this goes along with the actual files being contiguous. Because if the files are cluttered around, so to say fragmented, and thus distributed over non-contiguous sectors, the system will waste time again, this time on random read to find all the fragments. So defragmenting the hard drive every now and then would be required to keep the performance up.
At least, with the IBM PC AT now in working condition, I'm ready to throw another look into the Windows world, as we've been just coming from Windows XP Embedded just recently, and also touching Windows 3.1 emulation on Sun Solaris using the Wabi product. So next time round, we'll look at Windows 286. How about you? Did you own an IBM PC AT back in the 80s, or rather one of the PC clones, and what was your experience with it? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector, and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching, and see you again next Sunday.